Second speaker, it's Professor Michael Prada from ETH Zurich. Professor Prada was head of the Laboratory of Thermal Hydraulics and Paul Schuller Institute between 2007 and 2017. From 2008 to 2011, he was a member of the board of Swiss Nuclear Regulator, ENSI. He is also an honorary professor at the Nuclear Future Institute of Bungo University, UK. His study fields include thermal hydraulics, two-phase flows, instrumentation and advanced experimentation, cold validation, reactor safety. Today, he will talk about technique and instrumentation of transient two-phase flow test. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much for this very kind introduction. I hope you can hear me very well, or at least decently. So, I have prepared a very short talk that is partially related also to the activities of the Bangor University in the field of experimental thermal hydraulics, as you will see. But I would like to start to introduce instrumentation that I propose, that I developed, and that I also propose to be the instrumentation for the first experiments at this test facility Thor at the Bangor University. And namely, this is the wire mesh sensor. So the wire mesh sensor was developed close to the end of the last millennium. In 1995, we had the first experimental results with the sensor in Rossendorf. And today, Rossendorf is the Helmholtz Center, Dresden-Rossendorf. In those times, it was the research center, Rossendorf. And wire mesh sensors were proposed already by other authors much before. Unfortunately, due to a lack of deliberate electronic circuitry in those times, they were not producing very nice results. And we managed in 1995 to convert this or to apply an electronic scheme to this type of sensor that allows us really to do high resolution measurements with a high speed of imaging and also with a pretty high spatial resolution, which is sufficient for a lot of experiments. And the sensor itself is basically consisting of electrode wires, say stainless steel wires typically, that are spun across a measuring cross section. They have maybe wires that cross on an angle of 90 degrees. One set of wires, in this picture here, the horizontal wires are used as so-called transmitter electrodes. Short pulses of voltage are supplied to these electrodes. And the current that arrives at the other set of electrodes, the receiver electrodes, is sampled. All this is done with very low impedance because a low impedance driving and a low impedance readout guarantees you high imaging quality. But I don't want to give you an entire lecture on the function of the sensor. I would like to refer to papers that we've written about this sampling principle. If you don't do that appropriately with low impedance electrical cascades, electronic cascades, then you won't get a high imaging quality. That's that much I would like to say here. So, and we can achieve nowadays, my colleagues in Rossendorf can achieve measurements with up to 10,000 images per second with these sensors if you have 16 transmitters and up to 128 receivers. If you increase the number of transmitters due to the sampling method, due to the multiplexing method, the sensor becomes a little bit slower. And so if you have, say, 32 electrodes, you have 5,000 images per second. And if you have 128 transmitter electrodes and 128 receivers in Rossendorf, they managed to do 1.28 kilohertz still of imaging frequency. It's pretty high and pretty neat. Very big matrices of sensor can be arranged. So we have supplied now from ETH Zurich, before my retirement, to Bangor University already an electronic unit. We try to develop a low-cost unit that is more suitable, let's say, for small groups, for universities, because these big devices in Rossendorf are pretty expensive. So, and we tried this and we provided a device with 23 outputs, not 128, but 23 for the transmitting wires and 23 receiver wires that can achieve a total sampling frequency of 1.25 kilohertz. So this is available for experiments at the Tor facility, for example. And with that said, you can drive, for example, one bigger sensor, 32 times 32 would be the measuring matrix. And I show you the quality of the data. I don't want to explain that too much verbally. I have an animation that shows what can you expect if you use such a sensor, right? And so, but you can, of course, connect to the logic inputs of this electronic device. You can connect other sensor configurations, for example, four times a sensor of 16 times 16 crossing points. That's also possible. And so it's a pretty flexible device. 20 minutes of recording are guaranteed here in this prototype development, which is still not looking very industrial, but it is a research device, a prototype that we developed in Zurich. So for the future, we have founded a small company with a colleague of mine that is able to supply sensors. So we have developed a sensor with 16 times 16 electrodes that very soon can be also delivered to Thor if you need it. And so we can also supply, in case of an extension is needed, we can supply electronic units that have been changed in design and have to be converted into something more, a little bit more solid and more, let's say, standard type. So what can you expect from these sensors? What I show here is a flow map. You see on the horizontal axis, the superficial water velocity JL in a vertical pipe of about 2 inch of diameter, measurements that were taken in Rossendorf very early, before the change of the millennium, say 20 years ago. And on the vertical axis, you see the superficial gas velocity in an air water experiment. So this, the air velocity is the liquid velocity inside these lines or the transition lines of a standard flow map between bubbly flows, like flow, churn flow, wavy flow, annular flow, and dispersed flow. And there the pictures are now here. You have the measuring data from the sensor plotted into this flow map. And you can see here a bubbly flow down here. You see the bubbles cross. Now the measuring plane formed by the two planes of electrode grids, basically, that are not in contact. By the way, I should have told you that these wires, of course, have a small axial distance. They don't touch each other. And the electrical contact is only created by the fluid itself. That means wire mesh sensors can be used only if the fluid, if the liquid phase has an electrical conductivity, but usually desalinated water has a high enough conductivity to use wire mesh sensors. And you see here these yellowish and reddish areas, these are areas of low conductivity. This is when a bubble crosses the measuring plane. And the measurements were taken at about, 2.5 or 1.5 kilohertz of measuring frequency. This picture here, this animation above shows the slug flow. It's just now a slug past the sensor plane. As you can see, next slug is arriving. Here you have a churn turbulent flow, here you have an annular flow with some wispy annular flow where sometimes the portions of liquid also in the center of the cross section and so on and so forth. So this is the type of signal that you can expect. It's usually a big amount of data that is collected in very short time, and it allows a lot of very useful analysis. You can analyze, of course, the volumetric gas fraction, the void fraction, cross section, or the liquid hold up, if you like. But you can also identify individual bubbles, measure bubble size distributions. You can measure the interfacial area density if it is needed. If there is an interest in transfer processes at the interface between gas and liquid, the interfacial area density, or others call it interfacial area concentration, is a very important quantity. You can measure this with wire mesh sensors. And if you use pairs of wire mesh sensors, you will see the same bubble crossing, of course, the first plane and the second plane with a certain time lag. That means you can measure velocities. Yeah. So this is a bunch of data that can be extracted. So and what I propose is basically to put these sensors, of course, in the test sections of TOR. Yeah. Now, if you would like to go to annular flow and you would like to measure liquid film thicknesses at the surface, then electrical film sensors, film thickness sensors are an interesting option, which can be coupled to the same type of electronics, because you can couple electrodes that are mounted flush to the surface, directly at the wetted surface. You can connect them underneath the background, basically, in a way that is like a wire mesh sensor. So, and if you do this, you can do this one here with the same electronics. We have here a sensor implemented into a double subchannel geometry for our boiling water reactor related experiments that we conducted at the ETH Zurich. So this is an alternative where you use basically the same electronic data acquisition principle, but with a different topology of the electrodes, which are now at the surface. And you can imagine the wire mesh sensor itself is slightly intrusive. The bubbles have to cross these wires. The wires can be thin, 0.1 millimeter, but still bubbles can be cut in pieces. And so downstream of the sensor, the flow structure is slightly altered, whereby when you have a liquid film sensor, the intrusivity of the intrusiveness of the sensor is of course lower. So this is less intrusive. It's an interesting device. And you see here, for example, wavy annular flows in these typical subchannel geometry of a test channel in our laboratory, as an example. What you also can do with wire mesh sensors is single phase experiments. The wire mesh sensor does nothing else than detecting the local instantaneous conductivity of the fluid. That's why the devices that the electronic devices that we produce here in our little company, they are called conductivity sampling systems, nothing else. They are not wire mesh electronic devices, but they are just conductivity sampling systems. And the wire mesh system, wire mesh sensors measuring system is created if you couple that type of sensor with that type of data acquisition system. Then you have a wire mesh sensor system, right? And now if you have a water flow like here, this water flow in this main pipe, and you have a side flow coming into a T-junction, for example, and you use, for example, here tap water, and you use here, or you use here tap water, and you use here desalinated water, then you have mixing patterns that are reflected by local instantaneous changes of the conductivity. And you can put a sensor here, wire mesh sensor connected to the conductivity sampling system, and have this kind of information. So here, the really transient with a high measuring frequency, several kilohertz, you can see the mixing patterns downstream downstream of a T-junction. We did a lot of experiments in this, of this type. And now your imagination, or your there are no limits for your imagination, that you can invent experiments where salt tracers, tracer fluids that increase the conductivity of your test fluid slightly. We don't speak about very high concentrations here at that point, small concentrations. Can be used to visualize turbulent mixing processes, for example. We have also done temperature measurements. Don't forget, the liquid, the water, which is slightly electrically conducting, increases its conductivity if the temperature is increased. And so you can measure temperature fluctuations with a wire mesh sensor, usually with a much higher time resolution or frequency resolution than with any thermocouple, because the thermocouple is inert, but the measurement of the electrical conductivity is nearly instantaneous. So now I propose now to use the wire mesh sensors here close to the outlet of the vertical test section. This is a scheme, the PNID scheme of the TOR facility that is planned to be built in the laboratory of Marcus Dahlfors, who's here among us. And there will be a vessel, a pump, and you will create a two-phase flow by injecting near to saturated water in a test pipe and having a heater here down here that additionally causes evaporation. And then in the course of the rise of this fluid in this pipe, the void fraction, the gas fraction will develop at close to the outlet to have a pretty interesting bubbly or slug flow already with the means that are available in the laboratory of Marcus Dahlfors. And the same for a horizontal pipe. And now the proposal is to use wire mesh sensors here and here at these two points for the first commissioning experiments and start by reproducing, let's say, flow maps. So recording data, analyzing the data with the wire mesh sensor, and then comparing it to the known information in literature with a little advance in the sense that at TOR, you can do experiments with boiling flows at a pressure of up to 16 bars and a temperature of up to 205 degrees centigrade, which is also the operation temperature of the sensors that we have basically in mind for the application. So now to find out, can we do meaningful experiments with a pretty low heating power of up to 20 kilowatt in the test section down here or something in this order of magnitude? I developed the RELAP 5 model. RELAP is a thermal hydraulic simulation tool developed by the US NRC. You for sure heard about it. It's a six equation model in the background of this code. So it's a two fluid model with two equations of each type for vapor and for liquid phase, with all possible correlations for different flow regimes implemented, right? So and this is the nodalization, the pressure vessel. The pump is reflected just by a time-dependent junction, so it impedes a certain flow rate. Then we have a heated section of 1 meter length, the test section according to the today's, let's say, design plans for this facility, and the back line into the vessel, and in a cooler that removes the heating. The supplied thermal energy again from the vessel here at that point. And if you operate this, for example, you will find that at a flow rate of 0.25 meters per second, or let's say a superficial liquid velocity of 0.25 meters per second and a pressure of about 14, 15 bar in the facility, you can have of about 50% of void fraction in the vertical test section. At the velocity of 2 meters per second, it's still at the top of the test section, still about something between 18 and 20%. This is not so small. And so we are here in the bubbly and in the slug flow regime, if you want. And now what I propose as a second step after, let's say, steady state commissioning experiments is to conduct pulsed flow experiments. Pulsed flow means we impede or we perturb the flow by a sudden change of the liquid flow rate. So let's say if we increase the liquid flow rate, say from 0.25 to 2 meters per second superficial velocity as instantaneously as possible by changing, for example, the revolutions of the pump that can be done within fractions of a second in the small pumps that we have here. Then we will see a drop of the void fraction and also a change of the flow regime. This gray line is the flow regime identifier that RELAP also provides as an output quantity. And the flow regime 5 is the slug flow and flow regime 4 is the bubbly flow. And vice versa, if you again decrease the flow rate, of course the void increases because the same enthalpy is provided or the same energy is provided to a less mass of liquid. You have an increase of void. And now all these curves here are void fractions at different heights in this test section. So you see a wave traveling through this test section. The wave is of course fastest at the lowest position and comes with a certain delay at the measuring position of the wire mesh sensor, okay? So that is a very interesting set of data because you can take now the experimental data and compare it to these predictions of RELAP And I guess you will find out that RILAP is of course not able to perfectly predict the behavior of this pipe. And I will show you why. And Rossendorf also around the turn of the millennium, we did some air water experiments with pulsed water flow. So we injected air down here in a vertical pipe. Ironically, it was also a 2-inch pipe. And we pulsed the water flow using a valve, a pneumatic valve, a flap valve that was closing and opening very fast. Yeah? So and when we did so, for example, and see here, this is a process with the increase of the water flow at constant airflow, then you see a pretty characteristic transient behavior. And if you look at the RILAP results, you have a smooth change of the void fraction as the measuring position from void fraction A to void fraction B. So from a higher one to a lower one, if you increase the water flow, and from a lower one to a higher one, if you decrease it. But if you do that with air water, even without all evaporation processes, it can still add complexity. Even if you do that with water, you do not find just a continuous change, you find a gap. So there is, of course, if you increase the water flow, you inject the same amount of gas in more water, the void has to decrease. The simple transport equation issue. But it decreases in a very funny way. You have a gap where there are almost no bubbles for a certain time, period of time at the sensor. That's funny, right? And this is because you have a change of the drift velocity of the bubbles. At higher void in the beginning, the drift velocity is higher. So these bubbles swim away from these other bubbles that are not fast enough to take up with the first bubbles, and you get a gap of a second. And now with the high time resolution of the wire mesh sensor, you can see this effect. If you would measure that with a, let's say, delta P measurement, you might not even see this. So the wire mesh sensor has a sufficient resolution to do this. By the way, these curves were also obtained by ensemble averaging. So we opened and closed this valve many times, synchronized with the synchronized measurement of the data of the wire, or recording of the data that comes from the wire mesh sensor to get low statistic errors of the results showing these phenomena. And most interesting is the case when you decrease the liquid flow rate. When you decrease the liquid flow rate, the void fraction should go up. But what it does is there's a strong peak formed and then a gap. What is that? Well, let's look at it. Here on the right side, I have the wire mesh sensor data presented as a column or as a function of time. So here is t equals zero. And then when the time elapses, we go down in this column. This is not, call it as a virtual side view, but it is not a real side view because it's a Eulerian side view. There is a sensor at one in the same position. And the void fraction distribution is rendered as a two-dimensional plot here. And the vertical axis is a downward facing time axis, okay? So here you still have the perturbed bubbly flow before you start decreasing the liquid velocity. And then you see suddenly a big Taylor bubble arriving. And then flow with more bubbles, and then you know the gap. What happens here? If you decrease the flow, the same amount of gas is injected in less water flow. You have an accumulation of bubbles. These bubbles coalesce and form a Taylor bubble. But the Taylor bubble is faster than all the other bubbles. It starts rising and it starts clearing the void from a certain section where the velocity afterwards is lower. And so it comes that the void fraction change in time, the transient observation at the point where the sensor is, shows these very strange effects. It shows a sudden increase, that is the Taylor bubble, and then a gap, that is the region from where the Taylor bubble has cleared the void. And I can tell you this is impossible to be predicted by a normal hydraulic system code, a 1D code, unless you have very delicate models to describe, for example, transient behavior of the gas-liquid interfacial area concentration, for example. This was actually a plan to be implemented in more delicate closure laws for the describing the structure of the two-phase flow in transient cases into these codes. But we are still nowhere with the development of these models. So what I say is, let's do these experiments. Let's compare that with thermal hydraulics. And accompanying to this, we could do three-dimensional CFD or two-dimensional CFD calculations with different means, either fully resolved like Yohei Sato does, or in a, with two fluid models that are three-dimensional to capture these phenomena that we observe here. By the way, if you have a change at higher, this is a change from 1 meter to 0.3 meters per second of flow rate. If you go to lower water velocities, from 0.4 to 0.14, you even see a transient change of the radial profile of the void fraction. At the still higher water velocity of the wall peak of the void fraction, that changes to a central peak. Very interesting effect. This is due to the inverse of the lift force, according to the models of Tomiyama, by the way. And we can observe this not only in a steady state, but here with this pulsed flow experiment, also in transient situations. Now I repeated the relap calculations for this change from 1 to 0.3 meters per second of liquid flow and back to 1 meter per second. So actually this down here, this experiment, I repeated these calculations and it was the same result. Basically, you have a smooth change without any peaks and without any gaps. Yeah. So what I also propose for experiments at TOR as a third step maybe is measurement of measurement of void fraction profiles downstream or upstream of unsymmetrical obstacles that we put in the pipe. And we did such experiments in a vertical pipe in Rossendorf, such a half moon shaped obstacle. And since we know that the wire mesh sensor is flanged between, is put between two flanges, and you cannot move it up and down in a to measure three-dimensional fields, we moved this obstacle up and down with a two-strike. So in this way, we were able to capture three-dimensional void fraction distributions downstream and upstream. The below here is upstream and up is downstream of this half-moon-shaped obstacles. And by some tricks that I don't explain now in very detail, that is exceeding the time, I would exceed the time by far. We can also measure velocities with the wire mesh sensor, even if there's only one plane of one measuring plane. It is possible with some tricks and some, let's say, a priori information that has to be put in into the data data processing software. But then we can measure this. These three-dimensional structures. And you can imagine this is a cut through these three-dimensional structures showing here depletion of the void because, I mean, you have diverging flow lines where bubbles are pushed out of the stagnation point. Downstream of the obstacle, you have a recirculation area where void is collected. So they have a maximum of the void fraction. And you have very interesting phenomena, which is huge material, very nice material to test three-dimensional CFD models for complex two-phase flow situations. And you know, CFD is a pretty universal tool. CFD is very flexible in terms of changing the geometry. If you once have the right models in your calculational cells, then you can later on with a certain probability change the geometry to whatever you want to investigate, say fuel rod bundles with spacers. And the test data that can be completely different is just as to come from experiments in which you have geometries that are complex enough to produce phenomena that you want to model. Like curved, like the behavior of two-phase flows in situations with curved streamlines, the stagnation points, with recirculation areas, backward facing steps, etc. Okay, so I come to the summary. So the wire mesh sensor that I presented very briefly has a high time resolution and also a decent spatial resolution and is suitable, in my opinion, for a certain set of experiments at TOR, whereby, you know, in the future one can think of extensions towards gamma tomography, X-ray tomography, optical methods, or some other sensors. This is, of course, clear. But I think as a pretty low-cost instrument also under the bottom line for the startup tests, for the commissioning tests, and also for some already pretty reasonable and meaningful measurements in transient flows, this is a good instrument. I hope I was able to convince you. The liquid film sensor is there for extensions towards annular flow experiments. I think you will reach in TOR interesting flow regimes already with heating powers in the range of 10, 20 kilowatts. And the proposals, the two proposals I just repeat very briefly for first experimental regime campaigns. This is the pulsed water flow in vertical and horizontal test sections at constant electrical heating power, and the measurement, the transient measurement via mesh sensors. And measuring the 2D void and vapor velocity profiles up and downstream of non-symmetrical obstacles in vertical and horizontal, especially in horizontal pipes. Because vertical pipes were to a certain extent experimented in Rossendorf, but no vertical pipes, but no horizontal pipes with obstacles. That's still a very interesting field, but which can create lots of data that are useful as inputs for the theoreticians. So, and the purpose of all this is mainly CFD and thermal hydraulic code validation. It is not so much directly applicable to modern reactors or so, because of course there you have specific boundary conditions, specific specifications of the systems that you have to qualify or that you have to test. So thank you for the attention. I'm at the end of my small presentation.
Thank you, Professor. It's a very interesting talk from the side of experiment. Anyone have any questions?
Could I ask just a quick one, Mike Buck from Imperial College, your liquid the film sensors the for measuring annular flow, how robust are they as far as temperature is concerned? Are they, you know, do they work well at high temperatures?
No, yeah, but this is mainly a technological question, you know. We have in the moment sensors that are applied basically only in cold air water flows. We change the gas phase. Sometimes we use helium and C4F8. This is a gas that is seven times more dense than air to vary the density of the gas phase, to approach reality a little bit at least. But for the rest, the sensors are very cold, are for cold flows, room temperature, ambient temperature. I mean, that is a technological question.
Yeah.
The right materials, the right amount of money, and
yes.
And I mean, there is one really important. So in other words, if you want, we can go to any parameters if you have the right materials.
Yeah.
But the main limitation is, of course, that you have a structure that consists of electrical insulators on top of which you have electrodes. So that is very tricky to have this applied to heated or cooled surfaces.
Mm. Sure.
So it's more or less the dynamic of the annular flow in adiabatic cases you can study. Yeah? But it is very, let's say, it is maybe near to impossible to apply this to heated surfaces.
Sure.
Again, I mean, if you have the right materials that have a high thermal conductivity and are still not conducting the current as an insulating layer, you may do that, but
But
then you apply different techniques.
Yeah, sure.
We have applied X-ray imaging, and we are able to measure very thin films in the region of several micrometers.
Yeah.
Only. That is possible with X-rays, of course.
Yes.
And this is then the alternative.
Yes.
You will have other problems. The resolution is you have more noise, you have less time resolution, etc.
Understood. Thank you.
So measuring technology is every technology that is existing has also has always a certain range of applicability. And if you go beyond, you need to take something else.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any more questions?
Could I ask another one? You've highlighted the shortcomings of RELAP, and you said the intention was to adapt that, but you was to include new models within RELAP.
Yeah, and good. I mean, that was very short. One can make an entire lecture out of it.
Yeah.
The problem of thermal hydraulic codes, classical codes, or the application of steady state flow maps.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that was the idea was born pretty much a time ago, right? To develop so-called dynamic flow maps. Mm. Because if you can imagine, if you have a sudden change of the void, say by flashing,
you don't really have
the energy. It takes time to establish a slug flow.
Yeah.
And then these time constants, so Ishii, for example, proposed then the interfacial area transport modeling, which basically gives the interfacial area concentration or the interfacial area density, sometimes even groups for two double size groups or more, and own dynamics, their own dynamic, own degrees of freedom, own differential equations.
Yeah.
But in the end, this was, if you look today in the literature, it is not so successful.
No.
And then there are many people that struggle with this. That's why I think this is always the question: to which extent you need this? If your process, is really needing such a description or not? But if it does, then you have a problem. And then you mean I can say, Tor is a facility that, by its dimensions and by its parameters, is not suitable to every but every industry. So you have to find fields of application that are more in the academic and more in the in the area of code development and of physics and of fluid dynamics as such, then it's useful. That's why I think transient experiments that I propose have the beauty that they can be done pretty easily without big modifications. And this is a good start for this.
Yes, very much so. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Shall we go to our last speaker today?